Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining my webinar. Thank you, Venkat sir and Asad sir, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to do this for our juniors, and which I always wanted to do for a very long time. Thank you, Vijay Raja sir, for introducing. And now let's get into today's topic, which is emerging trends in aerospace engineering. I am hoping this webinar will be mostly interactive, and I'll be touching up on a lot of possibilities in today's industry. And also we'll be giving you some information which, when I was in bachelor's, I wasn't aware of. So I'm hoping it'll be really useful for all of you. So to start with, so I'm already, Vijay Raja sir and Asad sir have introduced me, but I would also like to add upon a little more on who I am. So I started as a bachelor in my interest in aeronautical started as when I started my bachelor's in engineering with KCG College of Technology. So like they said, I passed out in the year 2017. And during my final year, I started my internship with Safran Engineering Services on the field of systems engineering. So that was my first step into this new stream. When I started, like most of you, even I wasn't aware of what systems engineering is or what is the strength of systems engineering. And I wasn't even aware that today the world would be moving towards systems engineering. So that is my first step. And I also did my final year project with Safran. So I did my project on developing a model-based systems engineer, or doing a model-based systems engineering on hydraulic systems for the landing gear for LCA aircrafts using MATLAB Simulink. So then once I finished my project internship with Safran, they were happy with my performance. So I got converted as a permanent employee. And my first project was with Airbus India as a subcontractor in the flight dynamics team, where I was working as a weight and balance engineer for Airbus helicopters, which is the H160 and the H175 series. Then after a year with Airbus, I understood the different knacks of Airbus and how their work culture is. And immediately I also got an opportunity to go back and start leading a team for a systems engineering project itself for an automobile industry. So that was the first time. I was still thinking that systems engineering was still to do with aerospace, but that was the first step where Mahindra Electrical and Mobility Limited was looking forward to introducing systems engineering process into their framework. So that was my first step into automobile. So I can tell I have a little experience on aerospace as well as about 7 months of experience on the automobile industry with respect to systems engineering. Then I happened to also work for about 3 months with the technical publication team of Safran Engineering, where we were developing some AR technical manuals. So that is also one thing which I have an experience on. Then I understood that now it was time to move out of the comfort zone and start learning and developing my skills further on systems engineering. So that is how last year I joined Supero, which is one among the leading universities for aerospace in the world, into their advanced master's program in systems engineering. This advanced master program is a 1 year program where it is 6 months of classroom and 6 months of internship. So currently I'm in my internship phase, and I was lucky, or through my efforts, I've got into the Airbus Toulouse, which is the headquarters of Airbus here, as an intern for model-based systems engineering for the leading prototype development. So, and my future goal is to again become a consultant or a systems engineering expert for an OEM, which is Airbus or maybe Boeing. Let's see how it goes through the line. So this is me. And so for the agenda for the day, for this 1 hour session, first we will touch on the point of interest of today's industry. Then we will look at some of the aerospace industries which are in India. Then we look into the emerging skills which are required to get into this aerospace industry, followed by the different options which you have after your bachelor's, which will be definitely interesting and will bring an insight for the juniors, which my juniors, which are the current third year or fourth year, or even any junior of mine. Then I will move on to today's topic, which is the out of the box discipline or the emerging disciplines in the aerospace industry. And then we'll end with a questionnaire session where I'm still open to a lot of questions from all of you. So first, majority of my experience has been on the aircraft industry, and it is also one of the most important, like very close to my heart industry. So we'll be talking a lot of aircrafts, aviation in today's session, but I'll also try my best to balance it with other domains such as space and drones and UAVs. So first, I would like to start with systems, followed by the governing bodies of the aircraft industry. Then the different certification procedures which an aircraft needs to have before it starts flying, followed by the different standards governing the aircraft manufacturing and development, and then the tools which are used in today's industries. To start with the systems, all of us here, or most of the students which are here, who are here, have had a class called aircraft systems. When I used to be in my engineering, Professor Nityanandam used to take the class for us. And it was that was one among the first, like on the aircraft experience for us. So where we were introduced to different aircraft systems. So all of us have at least theoretical knowledge on the different systems, or majority of the systems on the aircrafts. But have we ever wondered that all these systems in the industry have been assigned with an ATA number? ATA is Air Transport Association, which gives about 100, all the systems in the aircraft is divided into different ATA chapters. So for example, all of us know about flight control systems, hydraulic system, landing gear and oxygen. But in the industry, or in any, when you're performing your on-job training or internship, maybe or mostly, all of these systems will be referred to with their ATA chapters. So when initially I started as an intern, I wasn't aware of it, but I feel all my juniors need to know this. And all the ATA chapters, and basically all these ATA chapters will have few rules of design and how the system operates or how it should operate. So flight controls is assigned with ATA 27, hydraulic system ATA 29, landing gear 32, oxygen 35, and it's a fixed standard. So, and you can Google about, and you can research and Google more about it. It's available on all the open source, these ATA numbers and ATA chapters. So next is the certification. Before, there are many millions of aircrafts or thousands of aircrafts which are flying, and we can see them. But have we ever wondered what the aircrafts need to go through before it flies? Because aircraft is something which has the highest safety standards. So there are some certifications which the aircraft needs to get before it starts flying. And that's called the airworthiness certificate. Basically, the certification process happens in three levels. First one being the initial airworthiness certification, followed by continued certification airworthiness, and then the continuing airworthiness. The initial airworthiness certification is done during the development, or once the aircraft is ready and it is ready to start into operation. So for the initial airworthiness, they need to get something called the type certificate. The type certificate, once it is given to the system design, the aircraft design, the design cannot be further changed or modified to a huge extent. There are still clauses which allows it to bring minor changes, but it's still, then again, it needs to go. And again, if the changes are made, the aircraft needs to go for further again certification before it starts flying. And then there is something called supplemental type certification. This is given to when the airliner or the user of the airline of the aircraft wants to make some modification or customization. So then the supplemental type certificate is given, and the manufacturer shall not hold responsible for the supplemental or type certified components in the aircraft. Then the continued is performed is supported by the aircraft manufacturer, and the continuing is supported by the airliner. So that it is important for the airliner to make sure of the continuing airworthiness certifications. Following, all the aircrafts are governed by a body. No aircraft can just like that start flying. So the governing bodies of the aircraft industry or the aviation industry, is the first and most important one is ICAO, which is International Civil Aviation Organization. So they lay forward few guidelines which any aircraft manufacturer or any airliner needs to abide to before they start their get their aircraft to operation. Then there are other regional authorities or governing bodies such as the FAA, EASA and DGCA. So FAA is the Federal Aviation Authority, which is mostly with respect to the United States and some other regions. And EASA is with respect to the European Union. And DGCA, like all of you know, is for the Indian aviation industry. And one interesting fact is that, which I would like to convey, is that if the FAA is the, if any aircraft is manufactured in the FAA governing region, then it needs to be certified by the EASA. And if it is manufactured at the EASA region, then it needs to be certified by the FAA. So this is one small interesting information which I wanted to share. Then comes the standards. So first I would start with the DO-160 and DO-178. DO-160 gives the environmental standards, and the DO-178 is the governing standards for the all the software which is running in the aircraft. And CS-25, FAR-25, 23, 27, 29 are the part component standards. And you can find again all these information or even in more information on all this, which are available on open source. And I request all the students to actually have a look and look at it before you step out of universities. Then comes the tools. So in today's aircraft industry, mostly used tools, like all of you know, are into, if it is design, it is mostly CATIA. Then they use MATLAB, which is MATLAB as well as MATLAB Simulink for most of the simulations or to do functional architectures. Then there is PLM, which is a product lifecycle management tool, which helps with the complete lifecycle management of any product or service that the industry is using. Then comes NASTRAN, PATRAN, which are mostly into the which analysis and simulation of mostly aerodynamics and other few simulations if you want to perform. And there are many more. And one interesting tool which is currently used in the big industry is the 3D experience tool by Dassault. So moving on. Now you know what are the standards, who are the governing bodies, what is the certification. Now the most important and trivial part is that you need to know who are the aerospace industries which are existing in India. It is some, maybe most of you know, but I felt there are still people who are still curious on, so I want to touch on it. So original equipment manufacturers, the OEMs in India, are Airbus, Boeing, Lockheed Martin, and our own HAL and ISRO. But I would also like to tell that apart from HAL and ISRO, Airbus, Boeing, and Lockheed Martin are still more or less a service-based industry in India, or they might be manufacturing small components in collaboration with other Indian companies. Following on, there are many, many service industries which are supporting the OEMs, such as Capgemini, Altran, Safran, Honeywell, Tata, Quest, Ramco, or all that you can see on my slide. So it is easier to find a job if you are qualified enough and if you have all the skills. It is much, much easier to find a job with the service industries than with the OEMs, because OEMs have their own niche market. And they are looking for much more experienced or someone who has more than a bachelor degree. Whereas, again, if you are someone who has the most indigenous skills, then you have your doors open even at the OEMs. Then this industry is something which is very fascinating for me, the MRO, the maintenance, repair and overhaul industry. Here is where in the service industry, you will still be working on the engineering part, or you will be working, looking at all the components from using your computers. But in the MRO industry, you will be able to touch and feel all that you have learned in your bachelor's. So the MROs are also something which is very interesting to work with. The few examples of the MROs is the Airworks, Lufthansa Technique, TAL, but there are many more like Air India MROs. You can try and look for jobs even in these. So now I've shown you who are the industries which are there, where you can look for jobs, what are the different governing bodies. Now, to get a job or to find yourself as the most eligible candidate, what are the new skills which the industry is looking on? The first one is out of the box thinking. Out of the box thinking is nothing but how creative and how from different aspects of the problem you can look in. And you can finally propose a better solution. So if you look at a problem with just one solution point, you might miss out on the others. Whereas there might be much, much more efficient solutions which are there in the other neglected solutions which you have overlooked. So this is called the out-of-the-box thinking. Then comes adaptability. Today, no industry wants you to just work with one single team or in just one location or environment. So the more and more you are adaptable, be it with the team, be it with the environment, or even your adaptability to learn new skills and then start using your new skills is also something which the industry is looking in you. So adaptability is the second most important skill. Then comes cross-functionality or the cross-functional working ability, which is today, if you want to sustain in an industry, it is very important that you are aware about what the other team is working and if you can contribute to the other teams in your industry. So if you are from the design team, it is very important for you to also know once your design is made, which would be the next team or how these design would move ahead. So it is very important for you to look into these aspects while you are working in your domain. So the industry, and also because of the crisis and everything, if you are someone who can work cross-functionally, you will have more opportunities and you're much more sustainable in your industry. So this is something which is very interesting. And I have an experience that because of being cross-functional, I also happen to learn a lot, but also I could sustain in my industry. And I was one of the most looked upon for that particular aspect of mine. So please develop the skill in you. And then comes communication. This is not an emerging skill as such. It has always been there through all the years any industry has sustained. So communication is not about just the language you speak. It is not about having a proficiency in a language. Yes, proficiency in a language is necessary. But even if not, it is about how you communicate. Communicate is basically how you put forward your thoughts and you express your knowledge or anything you want to share in a very crisp, short, and clean manner. So that is called communication. So it is very important that that we have this skill in us. Then comes complex problem solving. Today, none of the industry is just facing, or even in a day-to-day life itself, we are not just facing or bombarded with just one problem. One problem needs to be further broken down. And this one problem could give rise to many problems. So that is called complex problems. And in today's industries, it is always dealing with complex problems. So this is one skill which is seeked in the candidates when they are looking for job profiles. Then the most important skill for today's world is emotional intelligence, which is, I can give you some example. So if you are in an industry, or if you are even in your day-to-day life, you might be facing with your own problems, but how do you face it? And there could be different situations where you need to be strict with your other teammates, but at the same time, you also need to be compassionate. And also you should be focused. So that is called emotional intelligence. You should not let yourself be disturbed by some failures, or you should just not step back. It's always important that you have a balanced lifestyle. So that is called emotional intelligence. And it is very, very important for today's world. So these are the six skills which I wanted to highlight. There are many more, which again, when I was in my university, which in my bachelor's, which I had been trained on before our placements. But apart from that, these are some things which are also important. Now, so what are the different options after your bachelor's? First option is to pursue your higher education. So if you want to pursue your higher education in India, then you can give one option is to write the GATE exam and then get into an IIT, NAL or IISc. But these are not just the only options. There are many, many other options which you can further research on. And maybe you can find your interest in some of the other universities too. Then if you want to do it abroad, I personally, being from ISA Supero, I would like to make this present webinar more from the personal point of view. So ISA Supero is one among the leading, like I said, the one among the leading universities or the world-class universities for the aerospace industry. Basically, the ISA Supero framework or the syllabus itself is knitted in such a way that they take inputs from the aerospace industries here in Europe, and then they finally tailor a syllabus so that once a student is out of Supero, they are ready for the industry directly. So ISA Supero is one university which is like the sister concern of Airbus and Dassault and many others. Then there is something called ENAC, which is also here in Toulouse, as Toulouse is the hub of aerospace. So ENAC is, if you're interested in civil aviation, then you can look into this option called ENAC. In ENAC, you have courses like air traffic management, then air safety management, and many, many other aviation related courses. Or you can give your GRE and get into MITs or many other universities like Caltech or Georgia Tech in US. Or there is also one more interesting university called TU Delft in Netherlands, where it is also a very good university, but also you can pursue your research much easily after TU Delft. This is just personal experience. Maybe I'm not completely right, but with respect to ISA Supero and ENAC, I can guarantee. Then comes, like, I directly after bachelor's did not want to go for higher education because I did not know what is my point of interest or what is my subject of interest. So I decided to gain my experience. Similarly, if you still are not aware of what your interests are or where you want to pursue yourself or where you see yourself in the next 5 years, then you can go get into a job and gain experience and then move on to higher education if you wish, or you can still continue after that, or you can still continue working even after that. So first thing, if you want to gain experience, there are different domains which you can look for opportunities. If you're very good at design and if you have good skills in CATIA, then you can look at opportunities in the design industry. Or if you like making manuals, or if you're interested in different maintenance programs, then technical publication is one option, and there are wide opportunities or vast opportunity in technical publication. Then you have aircraft concessions. Concessions, like when an aircraft component or a part is flying in an aircraft, it is not necessary that once a defect is detected, it is not always necessary or always advised that the part is replaced, because for the replacement, then the aircraft needs to be grounded, and then it is not very cost friendly or budget or even budget or time friendly if you have to land your aircraft and then it has to go through some change modifications or replacements. Like how I know Raidu is here and he's a person who is much more experienced in this maintenance part, but I would just like to touch on it with respect to aircraft concession. So what they do if they detect some change, some defect, is that they send it across to the aircraft concession team who analyze it. And if it is a defect which is still possible to fly even without a replacement, then they just propose some other solution and the aircraft component continues flying until the next maintenance. So then you can look into also options in simulations and flight physics. So flight physics is a domain where you have weight and balance engineer, and you have opportunities in aerodynamics and many more. So that is the flight physics domain. Or if you're someone who likes to touch and feel all that you have learned, then the MRO industry, the maintenance industry, is where you need to step into. Or again, this is something which I am very interested in. Start your own. If you have some idea and if you think you can manage, it is always, in today's world, it is always advised to start your own firm. And these are the few possible streams where domains where you can start your own, according to me. One is if you're good at coding, then you can look into freelance coding for the aviation industry itself. You can sit at your home, just do freelance coding. Then CubeSats. Now you all know that SpaceX is, one example is the SpaceX. They are sending off their Starlinks, and they're more interested into Starlinks. So if you're someone who can develop small CubeSats, this is nothing but CubeSat industry. The CubeSat industry is also emerging these days. So if you're someone who likes space and who likes making small satellites like CubeSats, then you can also emerge yourself into starting your own niche. And then comes the UAV industries. Even UAV industries is flourishing, although with its own set of governing rules and standards. But this is also something which is very interesting and you can have a look at. Moving on for today's topic. What are the different out-of-the-box disciplines or the emerging disciplines which some of us are still not aware of, but is still flourishing in today's industry? So I would like to show you this graph. This graph is by the IATA. So the IATA forecasts that the air travelers by 2037 would increase to 8.2 billion. So next, what does it bring to your mind? Which means there are a lot of opportunities for all of us. But are we prepared to grab the opportunities in the right time? So let's look into the different disciplines where you can emerge into and you can build your interests on. The first one is urban mobility, the green aviation. Green, now the entire world is running towards sustainable and eco-friendly products and services. So is our aviation and aerospace industry. So that is where the green aviation comes into play. Then comes urban air mobility. For example, Uber or even NASA, Airbus, Embraer, and many other Boeing, many other industry, aerospace industries are moving to something called urban air mobility. This is where the eVTOLs, air ambulances, air taxi, and everything comes into play. So if you have interest in all these, you can look into this domain called the urban air mobility domain. And then there is flight dispatcher. If you're someone who likes flying or is very interested in aviation, but you do not want to become a pilot, or you are not very, you don't have the economic benefits of becoming a pilot, then you can look into this option of flight dispatcher, where you will become a ground pilot or flight dispatcher. And it is basically involved with the pilot flies the aircraft, whereas the dispatcher is again doing something similar to it from the ground itself. So that is the flight dispatcher course. Then comes engineering management. All of us are aware of engineering separately and management separately. But today's world requires you to balance out both. And that is where this subject of engineering management comes into play. And like every other industry, or like how the world is running behind, the AI is something which is very important or very significant to even the aerospace industry. There is a large data which is available in the world, and it also consumes a lot of space and size. But is it being harnessed in the right way? I don't think so. So that is where the AI comes into play, which helps to harness the data available and this AI makes things easier for us. So that is the AI in aviation. And then comes data analytics, which also goes hand in hand with the AI in aviation. Then comes configuration management, which is you have a lot of components, and even in your own houses, you have a lot of boxes which you use. So if they are not properly labeled, or if you don't know what each of the box is for, then it becomes a complete mess. Same as the case, if it is just the same case for just your small house, then imagine the case in aircraft industry where you have a number of components involving a lot of aircrafts. So this is also one stream which is very emerging. Then comes risk and opportunity analysis. All of us are aware of risks, but when it comes to opportunity, most of us are not taught, or our brain is still not processed to look into opportunities in the risks. And after this COVID-19 situation, this will be one among the discipline which will be flourishing. Then comes the airport design and management. It has always been important, but after the COVID-19 situation, all the aircrafts need to be still redesigned, and even the aircrafts needs to be redesigned for the current situation. So this will be one important field. Then comes the aircraft maintenance program development. all of us are aware of aircraft maintenance activities which are carried out in MROs, but also there is something called program development, which the aircraft manufacturers basically do. That is, it involves the development of the program which the maintenance MROs need to follow. Then comes safety first aviation, that is aircraft aviation safety. An aircraft cannot simply fly. There are a lot of safety standards that it needs to adhere to because it involves lives. So aviation safety is also a very interesting as well as a flourishing domain. And then comes systems engineering. So I am a specialist in systems engineering, and systems engineering is again something which is a combination of management engineering as well as design, and it's an overall package. So like I said, since I am a specialist in systems engineering, and as systems engineering is tomorrow's biggest thing, I would like to go deep dive into systems engineering and explain a little about it. So to start with, what is systems engineering? Systems engineering is a transdisciplinary and integrative approach which enables the successful realization, use and retirement of engineering systems and system principles and concepts and scientific, technological and management methods. So why is it called a transdisciplinary? Because a systems engineering is not just about engineering. It is with keeping in mind the project management part, the different domains which are working together cohesively to develop a proper solution or a product or a service. So that is why it is called transdisciplinary and an integrative approach. So why is systems engineering flourishing? First thing, like how I said, today everything is complex, or it is not just today, every time or always, it has always been complexity. So now systems engineering helps with complexity. And also one important aspect which the systems engineering helps to cover is that mostly there are several needs which the stakeholder or the customer puts forward, but not every need is taken into account. So systems engineering process helps to avoid omissions and also helps to avoid unnecessary assumptions. Then it helps to manage real world changing issues. And finally, it helps to produce a very efficient, economic and robust solution. So this is why systems engineering is important, and most of the industry is moving towards the systems engineering framework. It was first started upon by NASA. Systems engineering was a concept introduced by NASA in their Apollo project. So from that to today, systems engineering has gone through a lot of modification. It has evolved and it is what it is today. And it will again continue and further become a better and better framework through the days. So like how I said, needs drive the system and systems satisfy the needs. And that is the whole concept of systems engineering. You identify your needs and finally develop systems which satisfy the need. So in that way, it is cost efficient, time efficient, and also you satisfy your customer. So today's industry, it makes sure that the customers are satisfied. It is a very important concept. So systems engineering helps to maintain customer satisfaction. Now you know what is systems engineering and why systems engineering. And now you need to know what is the governing body or the backbone of systems engineering. The systems engineering is governed by something called the V model. There are many models which have been governing or which have been the backbone of systems engineering, but currently it is the V model. There are other models like waterfall model, but today most of the industries use the V model. So in the V model, you have two sides of the V. In the left side of the V, you have the requirement engineering, where you collect all your needs from the customer and the other stakeholders. And then you identify the requirements consistently, and then you perform a feasibility study to know if what you are going to work on will be finally possible or not. So that feasibility study is done during this first phase. And then you move on to the functional architecture, that is You now have your requirements. Now you move on to building your requirements as terms of functions. So you can do that using MATLAB Simulinks or any other simulation related tools. Why functional architecture is very important is because in the olden days, or even now in many industries, what they do is as soon as they get their requirement, they immediately step into building it. So finally, you have a physical body or a real body which they test on. This involves, again, a lot of time, a lot of cost. And so you need to develop many models finally before you get a proper solution. Whereas building a functional architecture helps you to look into the wide possibilities and finally choose one good possibility. And then you build your physical architecture through CATIA or CAD or anything. And then you test if your functions and physical architecture goes hand in hand. Then you finally choose one good architecture. You verify, you validate, and then you manufacture it. And then you move to the right side of the V, which is you get it tested, you get it certified, you integrate everything. And again, why integration is very important is because one component individually could satisfy your need. But when your one component is merged to the whole system, it might not satisfy your need. So that is why integration is a very important aspect, and it is done on the right side of the V. And then once you have integrated, you have tested, you have your certification, you go to mass production, and finally it is deployed, and then comes the maintenance and disposal. So basically, systems engineering process runs through the complete life cycle of any product or service. So now you have to also keep in mind that the right side of the V and the left side of the V is always done hand in hand. Or you, when you're on the left side of the V, you need to look into the futuristic aspects of the right side of the V. And when you're on the right side of the V, you need to make sure that all the things or all the aspects from the left side of the V are complied. So this is the V model, which is the governing body of the systems engineering process methodology. So initially, when you have your needs from the customer or the stakeholder, your system is always supposed to be looked at from the black box point of view. That is, what is a black box? You don't know anything, but you're just trying to collect or absorb all the information that you can possibly collect. So now your system is a black box, so that you don't start looking at the solutions, because once you start looking at the solution, you miss out on the other more efficient possibilities. So first you consider it as a black box. So during the conceptual phase, it's a black box, then it moves to a gray box where you develop your different architectures. Now you know your possibilities. And finally you perform trade-off and you finally pick one good solution and your system becomes a white box. Now, the important skill for a systems engineer is something called the systems thinking. System thinking is nothing but a discipline where you start looking at your entire problem or your problem setting or your system as a whole. And then you break it into different parts and make patterns and then identify the unique characteristics of each parts. And then you bring it together collaboratively and then have a system. So this is called system thinking, where you break down, you look into things, you know your aspects well, you know the unique characteristics of each of the parts, and then you collaborate, and then you finally have the unique characteristic of your component or your system or your product itself. Now, what are the different systems when you are building any system? Again, systems engineering is not just about a huge aircraft or an automobile. Even in your day-to-day life, be it what you are thinking of today, could also be a system. Or even if it's a pen that you use in an everyday life, even the pen you use is a system. And so again, your system needs to be mostly the systems are interconnected, they're interdependent, and they're complex. So what are the different system characteristics that are very important? Your system needs to be sustainable, it needs to be scalable, it needs to be safe, smart, stable, it should be simple, it should be secure, and it should also be socially acceptable. So you can think of any idea, but that idea that you're thinking of should adhere to the system characteristics so that it is finally an efficient product. Now, like how I have been telling, so far, systems engineering is a whole package where you need to consider risk management, you need to identify your requirements. It also involves human factors, software, hardware, verification, validation. Finally, you integrate. And also another important aspect is that project leadership. Basically, any systems engineer can become a good project manager. But it's also important that a good project manager needs to be a good systems engineer too. So that is the key of systems engineering. Then, so like any other discipline, even systems engineering has a governing body, which is the INCOSI, International Council on Systems Engineering. They lay down a set of framework and standards which any systems engineer or any systems engineering methodology based industry needs to follow. And then if you are very interested in this subject, you can also prepare yourself from home using the CBOC or the NASA Engineering Handbook, which takes you through the first step of systems engineering. And these documents are available on the open source. Now the entire industry is moving to something called model-based systems engineering. Why this is important is because what is the point of having something on paper? It is just accumulative. You end up having a huge document set, which might not be reusable tomorrow. So it ultimately ends up into wastage of resources, wastage of time, and also space and size. So now everybody wants to move into some models, to building models which are reusable, which are cost efficient, resource efficient, and time efficient. So that is where this methodology called the model-based systems engineering comes into action. And all the industries around the world, most of the industries around the world are moving towards model-based systems engineering concept. So model-based systems engineering is nothing but you are formalizing an application of modeling to support system requirements, design, analysis, verification, and validation activities, beginning in the conceptual design. And it also runs through the entire life cycle until the disposal of your service or product. So you start building your small, tiny models. You start making it big. You integrate it. You interface it. And also keeping in mind the different aspects of disposal also. So the model-based systems engineering is something which is consistent and integrated model of a system, where you keep in mind the architecture validation, and also you can reuse the models that you build, which is called the architecture reuse. You can derive your architecture for further aspects and unique characteristics. And in that way, you just need to change small values, and then you have a new product. So that's called architecture derivations. And then you can also produce your deliverables. You can exchange with the other domains and also the other engineering tools. And then you have different views of the same specific concern. So these are the advantages of MBSC, which is it provides different views of the subject. You have a visualization of the system characteristics. Then it helps to reuse. And finally, it maintains traceability. So one important aspect which any industry is looking for in their candidates is that when you're building a system, it is not only important that you look at your system from just your point of view. You should also look at your system with the other point of view, such as the engineering views, the construction, like how your system is going to be manufactured ultimately, on the science views, on how your system is going to be maintained, the maintenance view, and then the management views. So management views is nothing but the cost, quality, time, budgets, resources, human factors, and everything. So MBSC helps you to have a complete view of your system. Now, what are the different languages behind MBSC? Like how the C, C++ are the coding languages, even for the MBSC, you have different languages. And all these languages are governed by a group called the Object Management Group, which is the OMG. So OMG has identified two languages, which are the key aspects or key bodies of the MBSC. One is the Unified Modeling Language, the UML. And then SysML. SysML is nothing but a derived language of the UML. And now SysML is considered to be more efficient. So SysML is system modeling language. You can learn about UML and SysML through open source or even many other platforms, which are now helping students to have a knowledge on these languages. So now you have your languages, but you need tools to run your language. So if you're strong in your languages, you can use these tools and finally try and practice your language. Or in the industries, these tools are being used to build MBSC models. So like how I said in the previous slide, SysML diagram, SysML is nothing but it helps you propose diagrams. There are different diagrams with different use and different values. So on the right side of my slide, you can look at the different SysML diagrams, and the tools running these languages are Cameo System Modeler by Dassault Systems, Capella, which is an open source MBSC tool by Eclipse. It is very, very interesting to work on Capella because you have a complete life cycle and the MBSC can be directly visualized and put into action. Capella is by Eclipse and they also have a lot of tutorials. So if you're interested in this discipline of systems engineering, you can download Capella, use their tutorials, and then try and experiment on this tool. And then comes the core, which is which personally, to my opinion, it is not as efficient as Capella, but it is still interesting to look at. And then the big B in the industry of aerospace or any industry today is the 3D experience, which is an end-to-end systems engineering tool. And it is being deployed in most of the big industries. So also the service industries are moving towards supporting this system. And in the 3D experience, you can cover your management aspects. It covers throughout the V model. And also it also helps to manage the different services between your stakeholders or between the customer or different teams even. So that is why 3D experience is very interesting. And currently the 3D experience is also providing, Dassault Systems is also providing university license for upon request by students. It is for the students. So if you are interested, it is just an online tool. You can get access and you can have a look at 3D experience. Now, what are the big industry or any industries which are applying systems engineering? Systems engineering is like how I said, it is not just into aerospace industries. There are also consumer and electronics industries, information industry, energy industry, transportation, public policy, like even for conducting elections, systems engineering is being deployed. Automotive, biomedical, name it and it is there. So most of the industries are using systems engineering methodology. Like how you can see on my slides, you have big B's like Airbus, Boeing, Audi, Mercedes-Benz, GE, Rolls-Royce, Tesla, SpaceX, Honeywell, Dassault, and every other universe. These are some examples of the industries which are applying systems engineering. Now, that is the part with with the information on emerging trends and what you need to know and everything. Now, this is one information which is very interesting personally to me, which I would like to share with all of you. It is very specific to aerospace and it is very interesting, which is how many of you even knew that before an aircraft starts to fly or even before an aircraft is manufactured, the design which is developed is tested on something called a test bench. So these test bench, virtual integration test bench. So this is the landing gear zero, where your landing gear is tested for different aspects. The aircraft zero, where your aircraft hydraulics, the flight controls and landing gear and everything is tested. Then comes the cabin zero, where your cabin is tested for environmental control system. Then the electrical zero, where all your avionics systems are tested. And also there is the aircraft zero is called the Iron Bird. And I was fortunate enough to visit the aircraft zero here in St. Martin site for the A350 and the A380. So the A350, the extra wide body aircrafts have their aircraft zero test bench, the Iron Bird test bench. And the Iron Bird is nothing but a full size test bench, which is similar to the real aircraft itself. And they have different pipelines and different electrical components. which are controlled from a cockpit, which is developed indigenously. So the to finally have the real aircraft environment, flying environment, and then the system the system is tested. So basically, when even now, even although the A350 is already into manufacturing and it is already flying, the land aircraft zero or the landing gear zero, any of these test bench is still existing and it is maintained. So that any new modification before it is put into the aircraft direct itself, it is first tested on this aircraft zero. It is an amazing sight to see itself, the aircraft zero. So I felt, and all these, the videos on these test benches are also available on YouTube. So if you're really interested, please go have a look at it. It's really amazing. And then there is something called SIL testing and HIL testing, which is software in-loop testing and hardware in-loop testing for the functional integration. So that is all that I have to present. So I'm now open to questions and hope you all enjoyed it and it was informative. Thank you.
Thank you, Vishwa. It was wonderful. I'll give my formal vote of thanks at the end. We'll go for questions. Since it is the questions are typed, I'll take a read of it. The first question was by Mohan. Of course, it was partly answered. Is biofuel encouraged in aviation sectors right now for becoming eco-friendly? And to add with another, he has asked another question in the same context. Can biofuel alone be used as a fuel, or it has to be used as blended with ATF?
Okay. I am not from the propulsion industry, or I'm personally not someone who has worked with it. So from my knowledge, yes, but I don't know about the second part of your question. So I don't think I should actually give you some wrong answer. So I prefer not answering the second part. But for the first part, here in Supero itself, there are a lot of researches which are done on biofuels with collaboration with big industries like Dassault and Airbus and also Safran. So to my knowledge, it is a very emerging field. And if you are interested in biofuel, please go ahead and do your research. And if you can propose something, it will be a big thing in the industry.
I think Raldo has some point to add. Raldo,
yeah.
Can you please throw some light?
Yeah, I've already, as I texted there, the research on this was already going and many countries are working on that. And even in India, SpiceJet has done a test flight with a 75% of jet fuel and 25% of biofuel in it. The flight details also I have mentioned in the chat. It took off from Dehradun. The aviation minister and the transport minister has also said the same, that we are also working on this just to minimize the import costs that will benefit us. And the second thing, the most and the foremost thing is to save the atmosphere by reducing the emissions, carbon emissions. So there are many research projects going on that, and the saving of hydrocarbons again is the major part here. So yeah, that is a good emerging field.
Thank you, Raido. The other question was by Mr. Hari Kishore. The question was, how is coding useful for aeronautical engineering? Is it not the work of CSE engineer?
Again, every industry today or any discipline that you're learning, if you're just, I can tell you from a very personal opinion, I am someone who used to not even think like how the person who has asked this question used to think. And I used to think, isn't coding just a part of like CSE engineer? Why should I even concentrate on it? But when I stepped into the industry from day one, I have been coding. I might not be coding on C++ or anything, but I even Simulink, MATLAB Simulink, which is the base for my project, finally a project, was based on Simulink codes. So coding just doesn't mean coding on C++ or anything. It is also Simulink codes. There are so many CFD codes involved, like how Asad sir has replied. CFD, FEM codes. So from a personal opinion, please keep off this mindset of why do I have to code? Because the entire world is running towards making things autonomous. And to survive in this industry, it is very important that you develop your skills or at least have slight knowledge on coding. That is my answer.
Thank you. We have another one question by Mahesh Shaktivel. What kind of softwares need to be learned?
So Mahesh, again, it is with respect to your individual interest. So if you are someone who wants to get into the design industry, then CATIA, SOLIDWORKS and all that will help. But if you're someone who again wants to get into the analysis or simulation industry, then you can start learning software tools like MATLAB, Simulink, or Nastran, Patron, Hypermesh. But again, if you're someone who's into systems engineering, then Capella is the best tool that you need to have, you need to know about.
Thank you, Vishwa. I think you can make a list of it and I can share it with the students. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. The other question was by Mr. Sanjeevi. What are the steps you have taken to reach this position after bachelor's? I think it was part of your presentation, but you can add some more.
So when I started as a bachelor, when I stepped into KCG College, or when I made the decision that I have to take an aeronautical engineering itself, I knew it was going to be challenging. But I had my goals very fixed. From day one, I always wanted to join Airbus. Airbus was my dream company. So from day one, I have been working or building myself so that I am finally eligible to step into Airbus. But also I would say I was a little more fortunate that right after my, even during my engineering itself, I got to meet my mentor in Safran, who actually molded me. And also KCG has been a biggest platform for me. Indeed, I think I'm one among the students who have indeed experimented and utilized KCG platform to the fullest. I have been, I was also the, fortunately again, I was also the outgoing student of, best outgoing student of my batch. So I was always, my motives were very clear and I was always building myself on it. So then I was again lucky. So I made sure I do my internship during my course of, before I complete my bachelor's with an industry. So I stepped into Safran, which was my first point. From there, I was again lucky like that my first job opportunity itself was with my dream company. But again, I wasn't very completely satisfied with Airbus India. So then I already started looking for reaching the, I was thinking that Airbus Toulouse was my ultimatum. But now I realize it is not. So then I started learning my skills. So I found my interest in systems engineering. So I started developing myself regularly. I'm very active on LinkedIn and I try to connect with people. I try to read through what are the new trends, and I go also have interactions with them there. So LinkedIn is my biggest platform where I learn a lot of new things, as well as I get to interact and stay in contact with the big, at least the knowledgeable people or experienced people in this industry. So then I again knew that Supero was my next key card to step into Airbus. So I came here, and Supero is the only university, at least to my knowledge, after all the research I have done before choosing it, Supero is only university which gives you a complete experience of systems engineering. So I chose Supero, and again, all that I did in KCG and my work, it got me the eligibility into Supero. So then I'm here in Supero. And then again, it was not easy to find an internship with Airbus. Although you're from Supero, although you have your experiences, Airbus is very picky about its candidates. So you need to, basically, it's all in your hands. If you are really passionate about what you want to do, and it is not like how, at least these days, it is not like how it used to be even when I was in my engineering. When I was in my bachelor's, we're still new. We were not very aware. But today, and this COVID-19 situation of staying at home, literally this is the situation where I developed further on my knowledge, and I'm still developing. I'm still not completely perfect. So every day is a learning day. And if you can put to use this particular time frame that you have, indeed it is a luck. All of us are very lucky that it is a bad situation, but if you want to make use of it, this is the right time to build yourself, build contacts. LinkedIn is a big platform. Put it to complete use. And then you can also reach wherever. I mean, I'm not telling I've reached where I want to be. My dreams are still there. But at least whatever I have been, I was fortunate. But also, I had done some small steps. And these were those.
Okay, thank you, Vishwa. For participants, I would like to mention some words. Vishwa was visible everywhere in the department when she was studying. When you see, we have conducted some sports event on behalf of KCG at YMCA and also at Nehru Stadium. She will be a compere there, right? And yes. You take, name any project competition, she will be there. And I remember an incident, we were supposed to project the DRDL project to some of the delegates and we were running short of the students. And suddenly Vishwa has come and she has done a very good, wonderful job. I still have that picture. Maybe at the end, I will send it to personally to Vishwa. Thank you. We have other question with Mr. Akash. May I know about the artificial intelligence in aerospace and big industries like Boeing and Airbus? Are they working on it?
Definitely, Akash. From my personal experience itself, I was in Safran, India. And Safran, India was working completely into AI. So Airbus and Boeing, I know because I am currently in search of jobs and even during my search for internships. So I find that every industry, basically everything wants, if you see in another, I think 10 or not even 10, less than 10 or 5 years, all the industries would have gone autonomous. So every industry wants to go completely autonomous. And AI is the key card to go autonomous. And again, like how I said, there is a lot of data. Even if you now just look, there are many softwares or tools from where you can collect aircraft data. So if you look into it, you have a lot of data, but how do you synthesize it? There is, so that is where AI comes into play. And Airbus, Boeing, or any industry, even there are a lot of, like Tesla itself, the car is an AI-based car. So that is where AI is into importance. So if you're someone who's interested in it, please build your knowledge on it. And it's very helpful and it's very interesting also.
Okay. We have other question by Balaji Parthiban. Do you think robots can replace human in maintenance field?
No, robots cannot completely replace humans. No industry or then even the world cannot go without human interactions. So even if you have a robot, it is again, the humans who are finally driving it. You can train your robot. Even now, I don't think there is no complete robot to replace a human being. It has its own flaws because it might not have the emotional quotient or there is something beyond coding or set standards and frameworks. There is something called emotional quotient, psychometric quotients, and which is very important. So robots cannot completely replace human. Even if robots are there, human interactions are necessary. And I'm 100% sure none of the aircrafts are going to go completely autopilot, even through the years. And that is why else autopilot can just already all the aircrafts can start flying in autopilot, right? Which already most of the pilots do, except for the landing and takeoff and some parts of the aviation. Most of the time it's on autopilot already. But to gain confidence, no human being will be like completely confident to take a flight if it is going to be on autopilot. So human factors play a huge role. And so robots will not replace, at least to my view or from my understanding, robots cannot completely replace any industry.
Okay, thank you. And other question was, is there currently any scope for aerospace structural engineers? Does any industry recruit aerospace engineers or structural engineers for that post? It's regarding aerospace engineering. Vishwa, we have started a new course.
Okay.
We have reduced the intake by 60 and we have started aerospace engineering. So,
okay.
I think the question is from those students.
I am in Supero and Supero's also, it doesn't give aeronautical separately. So it's always aerospace. So I will talk from maybe Supero context itself. Even for aeronautical, like even when I was in bachelor's, we did have subjects on space. And I still remember presenting a paper for ISRO for SHAR on, which was on aerospace only. It was on the rocket nozzles. So again, structure is very important. If I have to talk from the aeronautical aspects, we do have specialization in structures even in Supero. Last year it was flourishing very well, but now because of the corona issue, no, at least Airbus is not recruiting. I mean, again, if you're looking for after 1 year or after maybe 6 months, if I have to answer from current aspect or current point of view, there is no new program which Airbus, I am not sure about Boeing, but at least Airbus doesn't have any new program. So generally aircraft structures comes into play when you have a new program. So if you want to get into Airbus or Boeing, I would say currently, but every, like the, it's like aerodynamic structures, they're all pillars of aeronautical and aerospace. So there will definitely be opportunities. If you are the best and if you are someone who is worthy of it, there are opportunities. But I would also like to inform that the sad truth is there are no new programs. So for the last, even from my personal experience, and I have friends, it was quite a difficult, it was a roller coaster for them finding an internship and job. But then there are opportunities. And with respect to space field, I was working with the, through Supero, my project was with Ken, with something called CNES, which is like how Supero is for us. ISRO is for us. KENES is similar to that, which works along with ESA. So KENES has a lot of CubeSat projects and space shuttle projects and a lot of things. So if you're someone who's interested in that, you have a lot of options. Even SpaceX posts opportunities on LinkedIn regarding that. You can also look into their page and there are a lot of opportunities.
Thank you, Ashok. The other question is by our faculty, one of our faculty, Group Captain Kumaresan, sir. Can the speaker give some lights on requirements in aviation field, the higher education and scholarship, which will benefit our students?
Okay. So first thing is the requirements. If you're looking for, if you are still in your second year or first year students, one advice I would like to give you all is you can be as enthusiastic and get into, you can be a very mischievous kid. It's okay. From my personal experience, I was a very mischievous kid only. I think I've gone to the HOD room more than most of them, be it for good and bad. So I was a very mischievous kid. And I was also not someone who has attended every classes or anything. It's not a good advice. But if you're someone who's very passionate, my advice is please make sure you maintain your CGPA. Because all the big universities do look for CGPA. That is the first eligibility criteria. So have all the fun you want to have, but also make sure that you, when it comes to exams and when it comes to learning the subjects, put your full energy and please be motivated to know your skills properly. And every subject is important. Please do not overlook, oh, this is the subject, I don't like this. No, make sure you know, because these are your basics. If you have a good basic, you can flourish. So that is the first thing I want to tell. So please try and maintain your CGPA. At least to, I don't want to give you figures, but please have a good CGPA so that you're eligible. With respect to Supero, they look for their eligibility criteria is you need to have a CGPA of at least 7.5 and a TOEFL score of 80 out of 120 or an IELTS score of 6.5 out of 10, out of 9. And then if you for advanced master's program, you need to have a work experience of 3 years. But for masters, you can just start after your bachelor's only. And most of the big institutions, this is the case. It's like 7.5 CGPA, and then you have to have other criteria. With regards to scholarship, if you have CGPA above 8.5 or 8, no, it's above 8.5 in Supero at least. If you have a CGPA of above 8.5, you're eligible for scholarships. And at least the European Union provides a lot of scholarships. Like you have complete tuition fee waiver, you have living expenditure coverage, Like I know my friends here who have a tuition fee waiver plus every month of 800 euros for their living expense. So that is one advantage of studying in Europe, because you have a lot of benefit and the government supports you really well. With respect to France, the government helps you with the medications, like the medical facilities completely or at least 70% free. And also it gives you, it covers your rental, like 50% or close to 50% of your rent. So these are the things with respect to that. And apart from that, the proceed, you can also have, I mean, if you are looking into coming to France, then the Campus France or the Alliance France also supports you very well. And please make sure, I mean, I would advise you to choose your interest. Or if you're very blank, then just go for masters in aerospace, because there also you are exposed to a lot of new subjects and then you can pick one. Whereas if you want to go into advanced masters, know your interest and only then step into it. Or be it for any specialized course like production engineering or structural engineering or thermodynamics or anything. If you are really, really interested into that subject, only then go into your specialization. So this is one small advice which I have. And I think if there are more, you can all connect with me through LinkedIn, and I do reply on LinkedIn. So
thank you, Ishwar. There are so many questions coming. The other question by final year, Shivam Kumar Tiwari. During your internship in Safran, what are the skills and values you learned, and how it helped you attaining job in Safran?
Okay. To find a job, yes, my internship was just for six. Okay, it was for 6 months. But I think the values, what Safran taught me was I was gifted to be under one particular mentor. I would like to mention his name, Mr. Mahesh Madhavan Nair. He is also an ex-alumni of Supero, and he's a systems engineer. And one thing I learned personally from him was that he was always open to questions and he was always ready to help. So that was one value, if I have to say, which I learned from there. And Safran made me again like cross-functional, and me, even when I was in my engineering itself, I was not just stuck to just one stream. I like experimenting, so I make sure I try everything and then I choose my niche. So Safran was the first step where I even came to know that subjects like systems engineering even existed. So that is a big thing which Safran taught me. And again, like most of the other European based companies, Safran is also very work friendly, employee friendly. You have an opportunity to learn a lot, or at least I was fortunate to have an opportunity to learn a lot. So then, and I was always very focused. If some work is given to me, I make sure I complete it. I put my 100% and I complete it. So I think that was also one of my characteristics which they were happy about, and that helped me get converted. So if you have an opportunity to do an internship with any industry, please make them realize that you are eligible, that you're worthy of getting a job. That if they miss you, they might not find a good candidate like you. So if you, please make sure you, and also you should give your 100% where if you're doing an internship. And only then job conversion. And again, these days industries don't just look for like technical knowledge. To be really frank, this is something told to me by the Airbus a manager here in Toulouse. So he literally told me, I don't look for technical knowledge. Yes, technical knowledge is necessary. And you learn that. And again, technical knowledge is something which you can learn through the years or through experience. But your values, your core values is something indigenous to you. So always don't let go of your values. And like how I said, these skills that you develop will help you read a lot. And it's basically how you interact with people also. So these are the values which I learned. And one more key card from Safran was the contacts I made. So all these helped me find a job finally with Safran.
I think there are so many questions. I can take it through the feedback and I'll personally share it with you. We'll go for one last, maybe two questions. club it as one. What are the coding languages to be learned? Which play a major role in future of aerospace industry? And if it is MATLAB, and which is the best platform to have a learning experience?
Okay. If it's MATLAB, I think you can do it with MathWorks only. They themselves give you student license, and they have a lot of tutorials on, like whatever I did on MATLAB Simulink was just using the MathWorks and their tutorials. Then Python is also one very, very important coding language in today's industry. So MATLAB Simulink, MATLAB, and Python. And Python, you can learn it using Udemy or Coursera, or there are many online platforms which teach Python. So you can also have a look at those. And one important information, sir, which I wanted to tell, if you are interested in learning about MBSC, Coursera is giving a free, you might not get a certificate. I mean, actually they're giving even the certificate if you finish it within your time frame. So they're giving a week trial on, and they have the course for MBSC. So it might not be a complete knowledge base, but it just gives you the introduction, which is necessary to have a slight knowledge on MBSC and to develop your interest. So you can look at this course at Coursera and you will still be able to learn something.
Just to add, for the students, the Coursera course is like we are having license. So just what she said, so we will get to the certificate itself. So students, if you are interested, you can go for the Coursera course. It's a model-based system engineering with certificate. We are having license.
That's very good, sir.
Thank you.
Is,
yes, sir.
So that is one thing. If you're interested, then you can definitely, I mean, since college is giving you something, I think you should make use of it. And that is also one advice which I want to give my juniors. When you have opportunities in front of you, don't neglect it. Even if your friends are not doing it, if you are interested, please go for it. That is how you learn. Like even when I was in my bachelor's, nobody actually even used to, the department is very supportive. You should be very lucky that you're in that department. They're very supportive. Make use of all your opportunities, because that is very long.
It's difficult for me to move away without answering this question by one of the participants. Can you name some streams of aerospace engineering which have good scope of jobs? Also streams which have less job, so that we can be careful in choosing.
Okay, if you are looking for a job directly after bachelor's, I would say, beat anything. If you're interested, just apply. I will not ask you to restrict yourself to any streams, because right after bachelor's, you're still not sure yourself what you want to do. So, and stepping into an industry is the best thing you can do. So if you don't want to do your higher studies, and if you want to directly go to a job, just take the opportunity which you get. Then from once you step into your industry, then you will, your view will broaden and your knowledge will broaden. Then you will have different opportunities, and most of the companies here are still okay with internal movement. So then if you find something more interesting, you can request your HR or you can request your manager and you can jump into it. So for a batch, directly after bachelor's, I wouldn't suggest any, like, you know, restricting yourself to any stream. But if you're looking for specialization as such, then currently I would say, look for the new trends. I mean, you can just, you know, the best thing you can do is go into the different industries. They all have their career page. Like Airbus has their career page. Safran, every industry, name it, and everything has career page. So go look at the career page, and you will be able to identify what are the most posted opportunities. So that is the best way, for at least in today's trend, because you don't know what's going to happen next. It is all still a big question mark, like how the industry is going to evolve. So it is very important that you go through, this is one good practice you can do. Go to the career website, look at what they are posting frequently, and then develop the skills for that. And in your resume, one biggest advice which I can give you is, when you are, again, resumes are modifiable. It is not necessary that you should have one fixed resume for every job that you apply. So depending upon on the career website, or if you find an opportunity, they will give you some responsibilities and they would have sorry, they would have mentioned about some keywords. Make sure those keywords are there on your resume. Today, all the big firms and companies, what they do is they do automatic check. So when they post something, you post your resume. Then the computer or a software checks your resume for the keywords. And when the keywords are matching, then it goes to the next level. It is only after that your resume gets into a HR or a manager's hand. So build your resume in such a way. So you tweak it, you mold it according to the opportunity.
Okay, thank you. I think there are so many questions to answer. There are some interesting questions by one participant. I'm not able to see his name, unfortunately. Okay, if participants, if you have any other questions, please follow the feedback link. You have some page to give some comments. You can post your question. I'll make sure that it is answered. I'll quickly take this to Mr. Raidu. He has some points to appreciate about the issue. Raidu?
Yeah, thank you, sir. I would like to thank Vishwa for giving such a beautiful presentation. I was very happy for seeing the word cross-functional. So this cross-functional, for each and every student now in this particular stage, you have to think about this word cross-functional. So when your structures professor enter in, then our propulsion or aerodynamics. Finally, end of the day, you are an aeronautical engineer and you have to think about all three. Yeah, interests might differ. So your interest might be in propulsion or interest might be in aerodynamics. So your interest might be in structures. But again, so because everything is interrelated. I will tell you one simple example. So if you are doing your M3, transformation partial differential equation. So you will be thinking, why am I studying all this? So, but when you start doing finite element methods, and when you go for CFD, only then you will come to know that, yeah, we have studied this somewhere. So everything is interlinked, but only thing, the curriculum is designed in such a way that it is just to give a brief for everyone at a basic level. So that is where the master's arrives. So only then you select your field, then you go according to your interest. So what my suggestion to all the students is, curriculum is something different and your interest is something different. Build your interest. Probably every day, think half an hour about your career or about your interest. Maintain a book. Write down what all ideas you are getting and start discussing with the professors. Such a beautiful department is. You should be really thankful for being with such a beautiful professors. Everyone is having their own experience. So there are professors who came from abroad, who've done the masters and PhDs. So yeah, everyone are having their own experience. So the word cross-functional I was saying. So just curriculum-wise, be positive with all the subjects. But interest, you start working with that professor. Tell your ideas. Start building some projects, and never ever get tired of doing something, because only in the tiredness you will learn something, and that will be really helpful for you. And Vishwa, really happy for you to see this. Your presentation was really good, and this part of the webinar, I think the maintenance part which you were thinking, I think the GMR was one MRO which is missed from India. Yeah, that is fine. But yeah, it is a really informative session to all the students. And I would also like to thank all my professors for giving beautiful opportunity to join here.
Raidu, sorry, sir, I just have one question. Raidu, there was one question which is very interesting to me about the airport. I mean, it is not by you, but I want to just get your opinion on it too. The airport redesign after COVID-19. What is your opinion? Do you think the airport will have to go through some changes after the situation, or?
Airport redesign, that is again up to the government to take what measures they are going to implement with all the, how to say, It is up to the government to take any infrastructural changes. But yeah, the social distancing till the vaccine is developed is advisable. And I've seen your slide and you mentioned about flight dispatch. So I'm working with the flight dispatch in IndiGo. So maybe for infrastructural changes for the upcoming new airports, they might plan something new. But for current airports to change, because all the airports which are in the city, if you consider Chennai is airport within city, or extension of Chennai airport, that infrastructural changes might not be a better option. But yeah, as the air traffic increases, more passengers will fly, and we have to see what changes they will do.
Thank you, Raidu.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, Raidu. It was inspirational listening to you. I thank Raidu. That's Raidu from IndiGo Airlines. You are alumni from 2012 to 16 batch. Thank you, Raidu, for joining us for the entire session. He was very interested to listening